This is the first time that we have such a conference going on, which is also open to a large number of people. The Integrated Health and Wellbeing Council has put this together. And so when we first asked the question, what does flattening of the curve mean? Professor Kishore basically told us, in epidemiology, in public health, we have something called the number of cases that come in. And when we plot it on a graph, we essentially see the numbers rising, and that kind of gives us a peak on a graph. It tells us the total number of people that are coming in sick over what period of time and how it rises and kind of continues on. So the total number of new people plus the old number of people that are already sick become people under the curve. Sharper the number of the new cases coming in, the higher the peak. That needs to be brought down, which essentially, translating what Professor Kishore has said, we need to reduce the speed at which the number of people are becoming infected and also the total number of people that are being infected, which results in a flattened curve. Instead of it going like this, it'll go like that. And that is what is essentially meant. And spreading that out requires a certain set of measures. What are those measures is the question that I will now pose to Dr. Sanjeev Kumar. So everybody's talking about lockdowns. Everybody's talking about isolation, social distancing, quarantine. These are also, again, very technical words. I asked first the professor, what is a curve like? Now, these are also technical words. In very simple terms, what do these words mean in flattening the curve, which Professor Kishore has said we need to get done? Professor Kishore, if your thing can be on mute so that Sanjeev can come along. You're on mute. You need to unmute yourself. Nope. May I ask Dipanjan? Dipanjan, Ben, could you just, while we wait for Professor Kumar? He's come on. All right, go ahead.
Professor Jugal Kishore has very well explained what is meant by flattening the curve. In simple words, if one patient infects four, in five rounds of infection, the number become 1 to 4, 4 to 16, 16 to 256, and then from 256 to 65,536. And in another round, it will be 65,536 into 65,500 billions of people will get infected. When we put in place measures of social distancing, like
इसका मतलब क्या हुआ? Social distancing का मतलब क्या हुआ सर?
बिल्कुल. Social distancing के जो component हैं, कुछ तो सरकार करती है और कुछ लोग कर सकते हैं. तो वो जो सरकार करती है, जो केसेस आए उनको जल्दी से जल्दी डिटेक्ट करके उनको आइसोलेट करें, उनको अस्पताल में आइसोलेट करें या घर पे आइसोलेट करें ताकि वो इन्फेक्शन को आगे नहीं स्प्रेड करें. दूसरा, सरकार लॉकडाउन करती है जो कि आजकल चल रहा है पूरे देश के अंदर. पीपल कैनॉट गो आउट इन द पब्लिक एंड then you have to do measures yourself. People are the nucleus of any stopping or flattening of the spreading of the flattening of the curve and spreading of the disease. You have to follow measures. Don't get out of the house. Wash your hands frequently and try to avoid going to places where you meet large number of people. By doing these measures, if you slow down, one person infects two persons, then right. It becomes 2 to 4, 4 to 16,
right,
6 to 256. You know, from 65,000, you have reduced the number to 256 in four rounds. This is precisely what social distancing does to flatten the curve.
Thank you, sir. So if we do these things, if you can mute yourself now, thank you so much.
Sure.
Then what Professor Kishore said will actually happen, which is the rate of the rise of the curve and the height of the curve will both come down, which allows for a slowing of the number of people that will fall sick. Let me turn to Professor Agarwal. Dr. Agarwal, what happens if too many people fall sick at the same time? At a hospital end, you're kind of looking at the medical associations, all the medical practitioners. What happens if too many people come in? Shouldn't the hospital be happy? Arey, hamara hospital bhar gaya hai. What is the challenge that you are thinking of when it says too many people are coming in?
So let me explain it, starting from isolation and quarantine, coming back to the hospital. Now, the effect of this lockdown will not appear on day one. Whatever the number of cases is appearing today will depend upon the infection which have occurred 5 days back, because the incubation period is 2 to 14 with a mean incubation period of 5.9 days. So therefore, we expect some reduction in daily cases starting from 27th in Delhi and starting from 31st all over the country. Time to death is 14 days, so we will keep getting deaths occurring till 14th day of the lockdown. And after that, we start expecting the reduce in death rates. And if that doesn't occur, that means then somewhere we are wrong. And that wrong will only happen if we don't do testing in the first week. In these 3 weeks, the first week is very important. And in the first week, we should be able to detect all those cases who are asymptomatic. So therefore, in the first week, if we are not going to be liberal in testing, and if these people start getting infections in second week, and then they have to be isolated for another 2 weeks, by the end of 3 weeks, they will be frustrated. Because it will be something like they are now waiting for 21 days. And if this extends for them forcefully because they were not detected in the first week, they will be in trouble. And for that, Indian government yesterday has come out with the telemedicine guidelines. These telemedicine guidelines suggest us that we have to call the doctor on phone and he will judge you and triage you on phone. So triage on telemedicine now facilities are available. Remember, agar aapko khansi hai, to wo take it as a pollution. Khansi ke saath mein jukam hai, to allergy ho sakti hai. Saath mein bukhar hai, to ye flu hai. Only 4% will have COVID. Lekin sirf khansi hai aur bukhar hai aur sudden onset breathlessness ho raha hai, to COVID ka test karao. Don't ignore that on the first 7 days. Therefore, triage has to be done on telemedicine, number one. Number two is your doctor, if you have a simple SpO2 monitor at home, even if your colony has, and in that case, if you see that your breathlessness is not showing fall in oxygen, even if you have a minor pneumonia, you can be managed at home. So as long as possible, if you manage at home in the first 21 days, your requirement to the hospital will go down. And we even have suggested that COVID positive cases not dependent on oxygen should not be admitted in a hospital. If you want to conserve them, take them to a hotel or take them to a place which is away and in a resort, but not in a hospital. In a hospital, we expect not more than 3 to 5% of the society who is getting infected and developing it. Now, people are estimating very, very, very high numbers. I take the worst scenario, and the worst scenario is in Italy, which is 0.1 per million population getting infected. That much of facilities. If we triage all our cases, we should be able to do it. But the only thing is, government in the meantime must ensure availability of personal protective equipments for the healthcare providers.
Right. So thank you. Thank you, Dr. Agarwal. One key thing that we need to be mindful of, and because it's not a small closed conversation, many, many people, I don't know where all from, have logged in to watch this. So this is also what we're speaking is both technical and also of public communication value. So sometimes I will rephrase some of the things that we have said. Of importance, what Dr. Agarwal has said that we need to be mindful of is not every little cold is immediately telling you that you have a serious illness. If you have a cold and if you have got a little bit of a cough, no fever, then please do not get alarmed immediately. If you've got a cough, a cold, and you've got the beginnings of a fever, do make sure that you are asking for a telephonic consultation. And if you're running short on breath, then definitely the helpline numbers that are there are the ones that you should call on. Agar ye nahi hai, और हैं भी तो सबको हॉस्पिटल आने की जरूरत नहीं है. आपको कॉल फैसिलिटी की सुविधा दी गई है, उस नंबर पे आप बुलाएं और वहां पे आपकी ट्रायज होगी फोन पे, और आपके सिम्टम्स के अनुमान के हिसाब से आपको गाइड किया जाएगा कि आप घर में ही रहें या फिर आप अस्पताल में आने की जरूरत है या नहीं. इफ यू डोंट नीड टू कम टू द हॉस्पिटल, प्लीज स्टे होम बिकॉज इट कीप्स यू अवे फ्रॉम द रिस्क ऑफ कॉन्ट्रैक्टिंग अनदर इन्फेक्शन. लास्ट थिंग इज, वी डू नॉट वॉन्ट पीपल टू फॉल सिक to an extent where they are going to need a hospital bed. Too many people needing a hospital bed is something that puts a pressure on the already limited supply of beds and healthcare personnel that we have. That is something that we need to be avoided. Last thing that I want to pick up, and that's where I will pivot to Dr. Priya Ibrahim, who's just joined us from the director of NIV Pune. What Dr. Agarwal has said is this, that we should be in the early days of our lockdown be smartly using testing. And I believe that testing is becoming one of those awkward words for everybody around. Do we have enough tests? Should we use it discriminately, indiscriminately, judiciously, sparingly? You are at the, let's put it and say, eye of this testing storm. You are both certifying tests, you're validating the tests that have been coming in. What is our approach, Priya ma'am? Dr. Agarwal, if you can be on mute now, please. Thank you. Dr. Priya, we can't hear you. You're on mute. Yes.
No. Yes. I would really like to echo the words of the previous speaker, test, 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 because we really need to understand just how much of a problem we have in our country. So, yes, as you know, NIV was the first institute to start the testing. But we have empowered about 102 other laboratories within the DHR ICMR system to start testing. And we continue to handhold them. As we speak now, there's a medical college from Goa here who has come to be trained hands-on, and they will go back with reagents to start testing in Goa. So that is happening in the DHR ICMR system. We've also opened it to some of the non-ICMR facilities to start testing. And I think another more recent development was the fact that ICMR was able to communicate the assays that were validated by us at NIV, which could be used by private laboratories. That's up on the ICMR website. We will continue to validate whatever comes to India, submitted to our headquarters, and that will get onto the website. So people will have a larger, you know, array of tests that they can source with the validation criteria. So therefore, they can, whatever they can grab their hands on, they can use for testing both in the private and in the public facility. So I would think that's the way to go.
Right. Dr. Thank you so much for saying that test, 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 that we are not backing away from that. We are increasing the availability of the testing capabilities. You are now authorizing private laboratories. We already have 102 from the government set up. And so doing the testing, now going back to what Professor Dr. Agarwal had said, figuring out how we isolate people so that the social distancing or the removal from the pool of transmission is taking place, so that what Professor Kishore right in the beginning told us, that we can flatten the curve. How do you go about, Dipanjan, I'm turning to you, Priya ma'am, you can mute yourself now. Dipanjan, you have been in the business of enabling smart testing or figuring out where the cases are from your background in HIV and other infectious diseases. How do we take the tests that are available, say from the NIV labs, and in the private sector, utilize it in such a way that we are able to pick up people before and are able to make sure that they do not become too sick?
Thank you, Bobby. Good afternoon to all the esteemed speakers in the panel. Echoing on the thoughts of everyone, it's a very challenging time for all of us across the globe. Let me take the question head on and start mentioning that, yes, testing is authorized. We have got 102 laboratories, which are 119 have been proposed, out of which 102 are currently functional, as Dr. Abraham was just mentioning. And also there are a lot of private players, around 18 of them, who have been sanctioned to do the tests. Having said that, who are to be tested? Now, there's an ICMR protocol available, which allows us to do testing for folks. And it has been little, you know, expanded to include the contacts right now. We still haven't really got into the asymptomatic phase. The one question you wanted to home on to is that we need to identify people early, right? Before they become spreaders and make the disease to a much larger extent than it is currently is. In order to do that, we need to incorporate others into the system. That means those who are, you know, asymptomatic and others in the contact list. But to do that, the first thing is the number of tests availability in the country. Fortunately, the government has already authorized. We do have Roche, which has been approved. We have MyLab from Pune, which has been approved. And I think Dr. Abraham can give more details on that, which are the other companies which have been approved. But in even in that, we need the number of tests and availability across all the centers and a strict, stringent protocol to do that. It's not that easy, because many of the other laboratories, I know of many laboratories across India which are doing some of the other tests which may not be appropriate or even authorized by certain, you know, at least our governing system and the legal system in the country. So we need to have a regulation, we need to have a good supply chain management and authorization, and I think the NIV and the ICMR is taking a lead on that. So I'm very hopeful of the things to come in future.
Sure. So, and I'll come back to that, because you've kind of taken the broad principles of the testing strategy, but who do we test? I mean, at what time? I mean, like, again, I go back to what Dr. Agarwal had said right in the beginning. I mean, when he was speaking, there are people who will feel unwell. Do all merit a test? And how do we do that? Dr. Agarwal, I mean, if you can kind of come in here.
I want to add something. See, when we talk about asymptomatic, there is a confusion. People feel no fever means asymptomatic, I only have cough. Remember, 44% of cases, fever will be the only first manifestation. So fever may come a day later. On the first day, you may feel tired, you may feel headache, you may feel absolutely lethargic. And people will say, I'm asymptomatic because I don't have fever. That's one. Number two, I have a couple of my friends. See, I'm currently the president of CIMAO, so I've been talking to most of the countries. And the South Korean country says the typical feature has been, much before the fever, has been loss of smell and loss of taste. So anybody who says in this particular time, oh, suddenly I've lost the smell and the taste, the fever may come 2 or 3 days later. At that particular moment, you don't need to miss it. The third thing which I am doing is, Aram is live on my Facebook Live. So I'm spending 3 to 4 p.m. every day with the people. So what we are doing is asking them, anybody who says I'm cough and cold, I says get a TLC done and come back to me within an hour. TLC, normally in every viral fever, you should have lymphocytosis. In this way, you have lymphopenia, which we normally say is an acute HIV reaction. And if you can demonstrate that there is a lymphopenia, if it is less than 1,000, we know it is serious. If it is between 1,000 to 3,000, you know that you may be dealing with a COVID illness. Yesterday only, one of the singer called me up and he said that he's having cough and fever. I said, get the lymphocytic count done. His lymphocytic count was only 1,200. So the report is awaited today. So I'm also doing a clinical triage of cases to detect them from CBC. Then you can have ultrasound labs can pick it up if you have fever with cough. As we used to pick up a lot of dengue with the ultrasound diagnosis of gallbladder fluid accumulation. Similarly, in an ultrasound, if you can pick up a interstitial pneumonia, you know that this breathlessness is COVID unless proved otherwise. So every sector of the society, the radiologists, ultrasound pathologists, should be able to say, oh, this may not, I hope you're not suffering from COVID. So it is not necessary for us, even if the tests are not available at this particular moment, every sector can come forward and help in diagnosis.
Which is great. I mean, which gives me a real good pivot point to come bring in Rajiv Gautam, who happens to kind of represent the private sector here with rapid CBC and CRP testing facilities. because as Dr. Agarwal said, it is the one place, it is not just the specific testing that alone can kind of throw up the numbers. Opportunistic testing from the peripheries and adjacencies can also enable people to be picked up. So if you've got a slightly awkward, let's put it this way, blood count profile, that allows for an index of suspicion to be pointed towards this might be something. And so therefore, Rajiv, I mean, bringing you here into this conversation with all the other professors, I mean, you're coming in from the provisioning of a test site. People like you and the labs, I mean, what is it that you can do to enable more people to be tested for in a triage fashion? And then I will come back to the other panelists to then go deeper into some of these questions. But Rajiv.
Thanks, Bobby. And I think the experts has already told about the diagnosis, so let me not talk about diagnosis. But what is more important is monitoring and taking care of the patient with sequential assessment of critical status, which involve inflammatory, immunological, hemodynamic status. As of today, the studies from Wuhan shows that the CBC along with the CRP can be used to a large extent to access the critical status of infected patient. So the problem with the public health care is that, okay, somebody is sanitized or somebody is quarantined. How you know that whether it is getting more ill or it is getting better? So you can check with the CBC and CRP, and Horiba has a machine called MicroMeCRP. It is from Japan. It's a 4-minute test. It can be done near patient. You just need a finger prick of blood. You don't need a serum. You don't need any expert laboratory technicians. And it can tell you what's the CBC and CRP. It's just 4-minute test. And then you can just monitor it, that key, how to the CRP levels and CBC levels, as Dr. Agarwal told about the lymphocytes situations. So you can monitor it, whether a drug is affecting it or patient is getting more ill and more is getting better.
Thank you. Which then kind of brings it back full circle back to the professor of community medicine here, Professor Kishore. Because full circle, if you want to flatten the curve, and flattening the curve means making sure that the rate of people falling sick is coming down. You're slowing down that spread, enabling more space and capability available for taking care of sick people. And you have, let's put it this way, in your toolkit, both the instruments of lockdown and then other instruments of tracking people's sickness, how bad they are, how badly are they progressing, or how quickly are they kind of getting better. How would you put it all together into, let's put it to say, an overarching toolkit as somebody who kind of both teaches and practices public health?
Yeah, it's a very nice question. When we say public health action, it is a comprehensive, interventions are required for any kind of disease, which is of this kind of corona. Now, I can recall the same way which used to be in undergraduate, that we have, 5 level of interventions, where we have first the health promotion, specific protection, early diagnosis and treatment, disability limitation and rehabilitation. So whenever we are dealing with such kind of pandemic, which can have very huge impact on everything, not only just, the death, which is the focus today, but we have to think in other line, because it has the economic impact, we have, psychological impact, we have the social impact. So everything to be, handled at the same time, it is to be taken care of. So in health promotion, which is rightly going on, that we have the social distancing and, we are talking about the individual, how they have to keep themselves, healthy, and how they have to maintain their diet, their sleep, their, hygiene. All these are, making them more immune and more, good in their health. But at the same time, we are talking about early diagnosis, that is a screening and test, is possible. But remember that we have a very huge population, 1.3 billion population. And if with the rate it is going, the transmission, if it is RO, the R is reproductive rate is 2.1 or 2.3, then we were not able to test everybody. You know, it is very, very difficult. Today also, if you see even the government hospital, like the, you know, major hospital, we don't have a testing facility. So just, you know, even if you try, in next 1 to 2 months, we will not be able to have the good amount of testing of the people. So what is left is us, you know, with us, you know, the these kind of measures like the total lockdown and, you know, very good health hygiene and practices. But I'll tell you that we have to move beyond. And that is, you know, the disability limitation and rehabilitation. Now you are seeing that lockdown is creating a lot of problem. The people are not having food to, you know, eat.
We will come there, sir. Because each of them is another thing.
At the same time, these all things to be taken care of, you know.
Right.
Then only we can say it's a comprehensive measure. Otherwise, we will lose, you know, the track and may have very bad impact of this pandemic.
Thank you. I mean, three things that Professor Kishore said, which I want to kind of pull out. One is that we should not, this is not just about death. There are things that are happening in between that we need to be mindful of. There is an economic impact of locking down a whole country or the situation that we are in. We've never seen this before. We need to be mindful, because then when we come out of it, there'll be a lot of people who will be far lesser in their resource capabilities than what we started off with. There's a phenomenal destruction of resources that's taking place as we're speaking, and not just in terms of people dying or falling sick. There is a psychological component to it. People being locked in, especially in small spaces, small children, elderly parents, and not being able to go out, lack of information, lots of misinformation through WhatsApp and social media channels. Everybody seems to be an expert in one field or the other. Gives rise to a lot of anxiety. And so therefore, even if you don't have the physical sickness that is COVID-related, a second order effect is that there will be a lot of people who will need help in unburdening themselves. And that is a big, big ill health scenario that we are doing. And the last bit is this, the social unwellness. Even where I'm staying right now, I can see neighbors getting onto each other's nerves because they want to get something before the other person. Khatam ho gaya to. And that anxiety, that panic behavior causes out a lot of problems. And so therefore, in addressing that, what is the role of the healthcare professional? And then I want to kind of turn to Dr. Agarwal here. Because again, when you look at the entire medical association and the large bodies of medical practitioners, not everybody is going to be an infectious disease responder. A lot of people will be drafted into it. But there are these other things that need to be also addressed. How is the call going out to the medical associations and the larger medical community right now? And I know that you need to also leave. So if you can answer this and then leave, sir. And if Professor Kishore, if you can mute yours, please. Thank you. Dr. Agarwal.
So the first of all is the manpower. So Indian Medical Association has suggested that you allow final year MBBS students to participate in the clinical care if needs. Nurses may be given restricted powers to do a virtual ICU where the senior doctors can be available virtually, and a lot of the people are working on the field are younger people. In Italy, the average, the highest age of a person working in intensive care was only a 40, with the majority of them young women working. All Chinese doctors who are Chinese and other countries' doctors who are awaiting for examination can be enrolled, like if the government of India and the Supreme Court can say that give parole to all the prisoners in the society with less than 7 years of imprisonment. Similarly, you can waive off the examination of all the 1 lakh doctors who are waiting for their exam, involve them in an internship, and make them an army if they require. So these are a couple of things which Indian Medical Association and SIMAO, as a SIMAO, we have suggested it in all the 19 Asian medical countries. Before I end, I also want to say is that for me, COVID is an opportunity, it's not a disaster. I want, once the COVID is over, in India to be more healthier, less typhoid, less diarrhea, less pneumonias, less flu, pollution will disappear. We now have an answer in Delhi pollution, lockdown for those 5 days. Why are we just 5 days? Because now today's pollution in Delhi PM2.5 in the most polluted area is 24. So we have now got a study which tells you, and I also got today I've been following the deaths occurring in Delhi, and in the Nigam Bodh Ghat yesterday there were only 21 deaths as against 50 normally. The deaths are also going down. So we will come to know what are the number of deaths which occur because of hospital acquired pneumonia and which occurs because of traffic accidents. Because that number of, suppose we end up into 50% reduction in typhoid, jaundice, diarrhea, flu, and other deaths, even heart attack deaths will occur because the stress level will go away. People will learn to meditate. This is the first time people will understand how to give time to yourself. Abhi tak log kehte the ki mere paas time hi nahi hai. Now everybody has a time, and that stress may reduce the precipitation of heart attack and death. So I only want to say is every adversity is an opportunity. Let's take it, let's do it, let's relearn, and let's relearn our way of life, the purpose of our life. Maybe COVID has come back to teach us what the in a Kaliyug, what actually a Satyug was, and what is a different type of a feeling is. So I convey, Dr. Bob, to all of you, all the best. Bobby is specifically calling me here because simultaneously I'm also on a Facebook Live. I have at least 100 questions to answer. I would like to say Corona Namaste to everybody, because if we do a Corona Namaste, at least we will be able to prevent, transmission of COVID-like illnesses in future. Thank you.
जी जी नमस्ते भी कह दो, आदाब अर्ज भी कर देता हूँ कि दोनों तरफ से ये ट्रांसमिशन में हम ब्रेक कर सकते हैं. एंड व्हाट डॉक्टर अग्रवाल सेड इज आई थिंक एन अपॉर्चुनिटी बोथ फॉर प्रोफेसर किशोर. आई थिंक यू गॉट सेवरल नेचुरल एक्सपेरिमेंट्स हैपनिंग राइट नाउ. ऑलमोस्ट इमीडिएटली इफ योर एमडी एंड एमपीएच स्टूडेंट्स आर एबल टू पिक अप सम ऑफ दीज एरियाज ऑफ वर्क and do the baselines and track it over a period of time, we will not get such opportunities in a natural sense. Trying to do an institutional review board for such experiments is not going to be ever possible. And so therefore, using that would be very, very important. But, and I also want to kind of also point to Dr. Priya. I think with everybody talking about, let's put it this way, Dr. Agarwal, if you can mute your phone, please. Dr. Agarwal, if you can mute your line. Thank you. So if I hope that this also sparks a lot of interest among people who will want to do biomedical sciences. Suddenly, I mean, it's not the age of IT and IT enabled. We need that. But a renewed interest in this is something that I hope it happens. And you're a degree granting institution also from the NIV through the ICMR network. Where do you see that opportunity? And I'll come back to then Dipanjan and to Dr. Professor Kumar separately.
Actually, in this whole venture, we have seen some of our own postgraduates being one of the first to isolate the coronavirus, the SARS coronavirus in Canada. Our own graduate, postgraduate from here, who's now on the faculty or a scientist, she was instrumental in isolating the coronavirus here in NIV. And one of my own students from CMC Vellore, my own PhD student earlier, he's leading the team in IIT Delhi. So you actually see that there is a huge future for students of biomedical sciences in situations such as this to, you know, take up the torch and run and do the best that they can.
And this is where I'm kind of particularly delighted that Dr. Priya is here, because here we have, when everybody talks about NIV and somebody who's kind of leading the whole effort, we also need to notice the fact that it is a lady, it's a woman who's actually at the helm of this. And she also kind of points out that the Canadian graduate from India is also a woman who's actually been at the forefront of doing this. And so therefore, I'm hoping that this also signals very positively to an increased number of women candidates who are coming into higher levels of their training and leading the research and response efforts. And so that, in that sense, I want to kind of appreciate your presence and your leadership here.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bobby.
Which also turns me back to then Dipanjan and then to Dr. Sanjeev, because I'll leave this session because we've got another couple of minutes. Dipanjan, again, everybody's talking about R0. There is, I was very facetiously saying, there are a couple of epidemics going on. One is a misinformation epidemic. There is an actual COVID epidemic. And now I believe there's a new epidemic of mathematical modelers and public health specialists. Everybody seems to be wanting to become a public health specialist. As somebody trained and somebody who's been at the forefront of this, where do you see this scenario now helping us in the future?
Thank you, Vavi. I think you brought a beautiful question. Lots of misinformation campaign. But let me take up the R0, or the transmission rate for COVID-19 virus. As of recently, the WHO had calculated it between 1.5 to about 2.4. The Wuhan study recently done by the backdrop data, which was done by the Italian folks back there, they had mentioned it as 2.2. Okay, that's basic reproduction rate. I'm talking in pure technical terms. Let me be a more layman specific. What does it mean? It means that any infected patient could potentially, or infected case, can potentially infect another 2.2 people. Okay, that means if there are 10 cases who are infected, 22 folks would get an infection from them during that period. So that's the kind of basic reproduction rate which we talk about, or R0. Having said that, yes, there's a plethora of modelers because we have done initial modelings, and my KPS spans with HIV for a long period. So we have done lots of modeling cases in this, either while my tenure with CDC or with WHO. So in those two scenarios, we had seen lots of these modelings coming in. But many modelers, for that matter, are, it's all assumption-based approach. We have just got one case study from China. We have got another one in the scenario in Italian setups. We have one from South Korea. We have one from Japan. We have got some cases, current situations from US as well as from the UK and the European Union in general. So putting them in the models, we are assuming many things which happen. Many modelers will come up, but in general, I go back to the simple thing is, whatever kind of testing or factors you do, you need to put in the measures of control or public health measures, as aptly pointed out by the eminent speakers. So I rested there.
You rested there. I have to my job is to kind of translate. I mean, you started off, saying, yes, there's interest, and then you lapse into technicalities. I hope that the people that are watching this, we'll get a glimpse of both the complexity and also the opportunity that public health and epidemiology particularly provides in doing great good. You can come from the world of mathematics, you can come from the world of economics, you can come from the world of sociology and anthropology, and you can bring all those skills into modeling out how does our behavior transform disease dynamics. Can we be more healthy? Can we be less healthy? And it is not just the clinicians alone who will be able to sort this out. We need all kinds of skills. And it is unfair, and I can see that, and I want to kind of make an editorial comment here. It's unfair sometimes to see economists being booed out because of the models that they are kind of presenting. They may be actually more valid than sometimes just the clinicians doing their own work. In the world of epidemiology and public health, we are not restricted to people who have an MBBS and MD degree alone. We recognize the need for many, many people to come together and work together, bring their multiplicity of skills, because we recognize that health is not just merely the absence of illness, but it's complete physical, mental, and social well-being. And that requires many other skills. And which is where I kind of want to kind of turn back to Dr. Kumar. You've seen this whole thing from the Public Health Association, the Indian Academy of Public Health. How do you see this now? We started off asking about flattening the curve. We've looked at the opportunities that may be there for the clinicians, for the public health specialists, for the biomedical folks, for those that are in the private sector to bring in new tools. How do we use all of this together now to both flatten and extend the curve and look beyond to a time when, let's put it this way, not a post-apocalyptic, but a post-corona world. Dipanjan, if you can kind of mute your line, please. Dr. Kumar.
Thanks, Bobby. First is, I will come back to the model. Models are useful. These are the ones which help us in projecting how many cases we will see and what are the resources we need to line up. So for flattening the curve, models are very important. There are many of them because these are based on presumptions, but they give us very valuable insight. By flattening the curve as a public health person, you gain five things. One is you don't overload the system with huge number of cases. Second, you get time to build the capacity of the system. We talked about testing. Similarly, huge capacity has been built, which is called surge capacity in indoor patients, in ICUs, roping in large number of hospitals. Third is we buy time for researchers to tell us which medicines will work, and also give time for the vaccine, which may come up. But keep in mind, we still don't have a vaccine against HIV/AIDS. So don't put all your hopes in the vaccine, but it gives you time. Fourth, it gives you time to learn from global experience. Each country is suffering. As of today, 196 countries, almost all countries, and each one of them has a lesson for us. Fifth is mobilize resources. The lockdown is just not health. It is all the sectors come together and economic impact. You talked about daily wages, laborers. How do you take care of them? Second aspect from public health point of view, I want to emphasize, not everybody gets sick in an epidemic. The mathematical models, again, range that 20 to 60% of population will not get infection. They will be asymptomatic even if they get an infection. So roughly half, we don't know. Figures may change as we get more information. Those who get infected, 80% will have mild sickness. They can be treated at home. 15% may need hospital care, and 5% may become critical, and they may need care like ICU. So this is the distribution in population. Coming to infodemic, you talked about, I abbreviate is as idiot. Let's not become idiots. Idiot is internet-derived information obstructing truth. So lot of infodemic is happening, and we are all becoming idiots. I get 90% queries to me clarifying this is not true. So let's not become idiots. Get the true information from reliable resources so that we can address and play. Each one of us can play a role. Public population is the most important. We have to take the lead. Government can provide resources, but it is you, me, and the man on the street who has to make sure that they do what they want to do. The report at the right time. Don't overcrowd the system. Stay indoors. Wash hands. And bring down not only COVID, many other diseases, as one of the speakers earlier said.
Yeah, thank you so much. And so, I mean, there's an excellent summary points that I want to kind of reiterate. What we are doing right now, as Dr. Kumar said, is we are trying to buy some time. We are trying to prevent an overload of our system. During the time that we have bought, we are trying to build our capacity, or the surge capacity that Sir is saying. What if another 300 people came in sick all of a sudden? We have the capacity, and we are building that. We are also using this time to look at other people's experience, learn from their mistakes, and try and see what we can adapt to us locally. In the meantime, hoping that our bright young and older researchers will all put their energy and their wisdom so that we have breakthroughs, whether it's in the vaccine or whether it's in the better diagnostics or whether it's in a better management space, and be able to give help to others. All the while being cognizant that this is an economic issue too, and we need resources. As it is, health resources were always scarce. Health was never prioritized. For the first time, one of the side effects of this, apart from the clean air and the lesser number of vehicles on the road, is the fact that we have a prime ministerial level attention on health, and that the entire government is right now today in some ways being led by the health ministry. And so in that sense, it's a wonderful opportunity, and we should be mindful that we use it responsibly, both to save lives and to set up our approaches in such a way that we have a continuous stream of innovation,
application and execution that allows for better, healthier, longer lives. We are at about 47 minutes of this conversation, and then it's time to kind of switch on to another panel. You're all welcome to say. The beauty of Zoom conversations is that everybody can stay on, and you don't have to clear the stage for another set of six people to come in. But I will prioritize now the others who are coming in. So, and if you feel that you have to go on and you have other commitments, each of you are busy people and leading things, thank you so much for being with us at the ISW virtual conference of the coronavirus epidemic that we have right now. For the work that you're doing, for all the things that you're providing leadership for, we appreciate you, we thank you, and we thank you particularly for your time that you've spent. I would request Dr. Sanjeev to kind of stay on because you're providing the bridge right now for the next set of conversations. And if anybody else wants to stay on, you're welcome. But I'm going to ask the back-end team to now get on the other speakers who are there for the next panel, where we're going to be focusing on how do we look at increasing the quality of our diagnosis, and how do we look at care in tertiary and non-tertiary and home settings. So that's where we are pivoting to in this conversation. Thank you so much for joining with us.
Thanks, Bobby.
We're taking a minute's break.
Yeah. Thanks, Bobby. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Again, to those of you that are following us on YouTube, this virtual conference is being brought to you by the IHW Council, which was set up to bring together all stakeholders and viewpoints to figure how the conversation on health progresses. If you're leaving, I would ask you to then disconnect your line and also switch off your videos, please, if you're leaving. Thank you so much. So that's what ISW does. And today, it's our privilege to have had nearly an hour of a conversation with some very eminent people and experts, and we continue on with our next phase. We welcome Dr. Mangal, who has just now joined us, who is the professor and dean at the IIHMR University. We continue to have we have Dr. Harsh Mahajan, who is joining us, the chairman of Mahajan Imaging, the founder of it, and we continue to have Dr. Priya, Director NIV, Dr. Panjan, who's continued to stay on, and of course, Dr. Sanjeev Kumar. And I believe we'll probably be joined shortly by two others, and we kind of wait. If Mr. Gautam's camera is not to be used, can we ask you to please disconnect and then switch off, please? Thank you so much. Can we switch off Mr. Rajiv Gautam's camera? That's fine. Right. I mean, and this is an object lesson for the rest of us. When we leave our cameras, let's kind of not leave it on for the others. It occupies bandwidth and then also kind of shows up your domestic scenes to everybody else. Thank you so much. Right. We will not waste time. We are 3:55. We are about 10 minutes out from where we wanted to start off. Professor Mangal, thank you so much for joining us. Let's start with you. We had summarized earlier that the bringing down the rate of spread of the epidemic in our communities and flattening the curve, as we were explained by Professor Jugal Kishore earlier on, are important in how we address ourselves to the epidemic in India. Where does diagnosis play? Who needs to be given a diagnostic? What constitutes a successful diagnostic approach? You're on mute, Professor Mangal. So we can't hear you. So you're on mute. If you can unmute your line, sir. Yes.
Is this better?
Yes, yeah. That is it. Correct.
Okay.
Thank you.
Now, on this, the identification of disease is of prime importance when we are dealing with any outbreak or epidemic, because the objectives of any public health intervention in such situations is to prevent outbreaks, delay spread, slow and stop transmission of the disease. And the initial step is to identify those who are suffering from this disease. And the diagnosis, early diagnosis plays very, very important role. In this current scenario of COVID-19 in India, initially the government of India acted very fast on it. And as this epidemic was unfolding in China, we prepared ourselves and we started offering the diagnostic services, initially in the government hospitals. And very recently, the ICMR has opened it up to the private laboratories as well. So currently, not only we have this facility in 100 labs in the government sector, but 30 labs in private sector with their 17,000 centers, collection centers. And I'm sure with this expanded facility, we will be able to offer the diagnostic services to all those who are prioritized as per the protocol developed by the ICMR for this purpose. And we will be able to pinpoint or identify persons, confirmed cases, and take appropriate public health measures to isolate those cases and also trace their contacts more effectively.
Thank you, Dr. Mangal. I just want to kind of look at you. Did I lose Dr. Mahajan here? Because I was just kind of going to point to him. But if I have lost him, then we have Dr. Rajan Sharma, the president of IMA here. Thank you so much. And yes, you're back. You're back on. Dr. Rajan, if you can just mute your line, please, for a second while I get the conversation with Dr. Mahajan on. Dr. Mahajan, in the earlier session, we heard from Dr. K.K. Agarwal. He basically said that it does not have to be merely the COVID-specific test that we need to rely on, that other faculties of medicine and can also begin to contribute to an earlier pickup of those that could be suspects of COVID infections. And so therefore, I want to kind of point to you, many people are in their routine cases or otherwise also turning up in imaging facilities like yours. What is the role, what is the guidance that you are providing for the larger network in, let's put this way, additional capacity for diagnostics rather than just the specific test, because the specific test seems to be something that is limited. May I ask Dr. Mangal, I mean, if your mic can be muted, Dr. Rajan, if your mic can be muted so that Dr. Mahajan's mic only alone is available. Thank you so much, Dr. Mahajan.
So let me take you back to Wuhan, where initially the RT-PCR test for COVID-19 was hard to come by. And there were patients presenting to the hospital. And these patients who had, their x-rays and CT scans done, there were typical findings of, interstitial kind of viral pneumonia, which was seen peripherally located. And based on this, actually, since it was taking nearly 5 days for the RT-PCR report to come back, during the interim period, it was much easier getting the CT scans done and making a diagnosis. And based on the CT scan reports, they actually ended up upping the numbers by about 13,000 in one go. But that was then. And we are here now where RT-PCR is not so tough to get. And so the whole thing was recalibrated, where CT, X-ray, chest are playing a role in the clinical evaluation and follow-up of these patients to see how the disease is evolving, as we would do in any other, pneumonia. To see whether there is improvement, whether there is ARDS developing, what is happening, is the disease getting worse, getting better with follow-up CT scans. So as an initial tool for diagnosis, what the Wuhan episode had suggested early on, that CT may be useful as an initial tool for diagnosing COVID-19, that no longer holds true. It is now a tool which is to be used for assessing the degree of disease that a patient has in the lungs and in seeing how it is progressing or getting better. Now, right. Is there more that a CT scan can help in? We at Mahajan Imaging and Caring, our Center for Advanced Research in Imaging, Neuroscience and Genomics, are looking at getting enough of these scans and using artificial intelligence algorithms to try to develop an algorithm where maybe we can prognosticate. Maybe 5 days before a patient needs to use a ventilator, can we actually tell that, you know, if there are four patients in the ICU, who are the two or one who's going to need a ventilator and who is not? So this is where our effort is now, you know, located. Otherwise, radiology plays a role currently. And we see that, you know, on a CT scan, COVID-19 does have a somewhat of a typical appearance as we see it today. And based on that, maybe, number one, we can develop a tool where on a chest CT using artificial intelligence, we can say this is COVID-19, this is not, this is something else. And number two, the larger, you know, goal is, can we prognosticate and can we identify those patients who are going to have a downhill course and maybe institute therapy much earlier?
Right. Thank you, Dr. Mahajan. I mean, very, very useful. The transition from being the only tool in the initial days to kind of pick up on people with a strange set of presentations to today, now using it more to assess the clinical severity and the actually stepping on forward to using it as a prognostic tool for who might need more care than others is a very helpful let's put it say, evolution of the utilization of radiological capabilities. And we'll come back to that because Dr. Rajan Sharma, I mean, from the medical association, you're not just looking at the radiologists or the cardiologists, you're looking at the entire medical association fraternity. When we're looking at this time, when we are literally kind of building capacity, surge or call it additional capacity, what do you see as the challenges for you in the short term and then of course longer in the medium to long term?
Hello?
Yes, sir, we are audible. Go ahead.
I'm audible?
Yes, sir.
Just heard the last part. Could you just please repeat the question? I'm sorry.
Not a problem at all. So all I'm asking is, now that we know that we have a, let's put this way, a 3 week period. Now, as of today, another 19 days. We are the 20th day of lockdown, 19 days left. We have got a little bit of time. What is the capacity building or the surge capacity bolstering that the IMA is looking at or what you're recommending that we need in the way that we are addressing the pandemic as it comes along?
See, first of all, thank you for the opportunity. For the pandemic, before it comes, first of all, you have to get your forces ready, which has been admirably done by our Prime Minister and the people of India on 22nd of this month. I can say it has enthused and filled a new vigor into our entire community to fight this and take this battle head on. Also, as an association, it is my responsibility, leader of the association and the medical fraternity, I have to allay the fears of my general population. Keeping in mind with our experience from Wuhan, Italy, Spain and other countries, we have fairly done good at surveillance and we have taken appropriate steps whenever we were faltering. And lockdown at this period is a very historical decision that perhaps I know for sure this is perhaps the biggest lockdown in the history of world. Hello?
We locked down 1/5 of humanity at one go. So, I mean, it can't get any bigger than that.
Any bigger than that. Even America couldn't do it. And the loss, what economic loss we are suffering, is an investment to prevent corona in its offering. Because you have to see the humongous size of our country and its population. This was the best step which even in our meeting with the Prime Minister, the IMS supported. And now, coming to stricter implementation of home quarantine, we need to ensure quarantine facilities because majority of them get all right with home quarantine if they follow the proper precautions which are being projected by us, our members, our society people, and above all, even very well presented by the media. So now coming to the ventilator facilities and the COVID-19 facilities. I welcome the move of the government to create dedicated COVID-19 facilities, learning from the experience from Italy. In Italy, what happened? The COVID-19 positive patient was roaming around in small hospitals also, and which led to a very big spread of the disease. And now they are in a situation they don't know how to control. But here, dedicated COVID-19 facilities, dedicated quarantine facilities, and this period, while we are working on home isolation and current clampdown, lockdown, or curfew or lockdown, is also should be and is also being utilized to stock up our reserves. Where I am happy to note, during a meeting with the Prime Minister, the industry is chipping in. Everybody who is there, we are chipping in with getting our data of pulmonologists, general physicians, MD medicines, intensivists, and anesthetists ready, so that at the beck and call of the government, we are there to serve our nation at the earliest, along with my nurses, healthcare professionals, sanitation workers, you guys, police, who are there in implementation of all these things. I just want country to just not go into a spin. The people, they should just relax and let us perform. And not to create so much of panic, like incidents of doctors being vacated. If they are not there, who's going to fight this battle?
Fair enough. And the point that I want to take from Dr. Rajan is this, that the specific COVID-related facilities, you pointed out that in Italy, people were roaming around in smaller hospitals, and that led to a little bit of an amplification of the spread. That is something as a lesson we should learn from Italy. And in this case, it looks like that's our way that we are going forward, that we will put people who are suspected to be COVID to be managed in COVID specific facilities rather than in our general facilities and run the risk of getting already sick people to also get further sick, and also protecting our healthcare workers. That's a very, very valid point. And that's also something that I think we all need to rally around that idea, which means we need more dedicated spaces. We also need a substantial proportion of our healthcare workforce to be also directed that way so that we do not have an admixture of the two streams. And then that's a very valid point that you're kind of making. In terms of actually when framing it out at an operational level, let me kind of turn to both Dipanjan and to Dr. Kumar. And then I'll come back to you, Dr. Harsh. I mean, I see your hand. How do you ensure what Dr. Rajan Sharma is saying is going to be operationalized? Dipanjan, if I can start with you. In making sure that we do not have an admixture. I mean, it's operationally fairly complex. A sick person is a sick person, and he'll want to go to his nearest facility. Before that, I mean, I think Dr. Rajan wants to say something before I turn. Dr. Rajan, yes.
The first step in IMA we took was to decongest our clinics. And we started telling our patients of chronic ailments, diabetes, hypertension, coronary artery disease, immunocompromised patients to stay home and call as and when required. Second, IMA at the local, district and national level is working in tandem with the district authorities, state governments and the national authorities, in which these chain of power is very clear. All the district hospitals or dedicated COVID hospitals have been created by the government, manned by the government, and in full knowledge of the district. Assets of IMA members, private hospitals, ventilators have been shared by the district to the district authorities and local authorities, that in case of the existing facilities, whenever additional backup is required, IMA will be there to offer manpower. Will is already offering manpower. We have a lot of my colleagues are involved in ventilator training, like in the civil hospital and the ESI, whichever facilities have been taken over. And we are working seamlessly with the authorities. So now, when it is clear which patients we want and which are not to come, and we have at IMA did a full OPD protocol to be followed. And this is the way we have tried to deal with it. Let's see what the things unfold. Right.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Sharma. Dipanjan, I mean, if you can start off.
Sure. Thank you, Bobby. Let me start off with the concept. Let's take up the clue from what Dr. Rajan Sharma was just mentioning in Italy. Let's take the scenarios where things have gone wrong to understand what went wrong so that we don't fall in the same trap. Yes, decongesting the clinics, that's number one. Number two, that, triaging and sending the patients who are infected and being treated to a COVID facility. That is the key. How did South Africa do it? South Korea do this, control in this manner. It's the same way. They tested, they isolated, they put the social distancing measures starting from quarantine, isolation, and do not forget, hospitals are also should be coming under the purview of isolation. It's not that everybody, you don't let people just go to a grocery store or some other places. Even the hospitals are crowded and people would like to flock to the next door hospital for better facilities. But that shouldn't be the case. The policy matters. And the current public health situation in the country demands that we have, facilities which are isolated and specified for this purpose. That will really do a lot of good. So that's number one. And number two is learning the lessons from, Italian thing. If you look at even the lockdown from Northern Italy to the Southern Italy, what had happened was the lockdown wasn't enforced to the extent it could have been. So there was always a permeability of cases. When the number of cases and these infected cases come to the other side, yes, we will be able to control the epidemic today or tomorrow, even with lockdown, without lockdown. But what is the price we pay? The number of deaths you incur, and the health system burden and the breakdown of certain. So these are the points which we need to keep in mind.
So earlier, Dr. Mahajan, you had a point to kind of make. You were raising your hand.
Bobby, I'll just follow up where the argument is. Other bodies like EIIA. So many other.
I request Dr. Ranjit, can you just mute your mic, please?
Sorry.
Right.
So all these bodies have come together, and they came together about nearly a month ago, and have set, and this also includes medtech, because if we are to get masks, if we are to get PPEs, if we are to get ventilators, then these people need to come in. And the COVID hospital concept was initially given by a conglomerate of the entire healthcare fraternity, which included the IMA and all the industrial organizations. And I just have one request, because the government, actually it's the states which control all of this. There are some states which have already identified COVID hospitals, like in Karnataka, in Maharashtra, in Mumbai, in Delhi also, ILBS has been designated one. But at the same time, they are also asking the other hospitals to keep a few beds in the ICU vacant for COVID patients. I think that is falling into a trap, because again, we'll be repeating what happened and then it'll spread like wildfire. I think here recalibration needs to be done, because now I think by and large, the entire community, the government and the private sector are both agreed on the fact that we need specific COVID hospitals and not this fragmented few beds here and there. And sure. and so the policy needs to be dictated very clearly so that patients who suspect that they may be having COVID do not go to a neighboring hospital, otherwise they will end up spreading the disease. At the same time, it has also been decided that if ventilators need to be given by private facilities, they will give them to these COVID hospitals. They will also share manpower so that the government and the private sector stand shoulder to shoulder and work together, because it's a disease where the entire country has to stand as one.
Absolutely. I mean, no questions. And I think that's a lesson that is to be learned from what has happened in other places. Dr. Sanjeev, I will come back to you in a second. The lesson that we need to learn is to make sure that we are putting people specifically into designated facilities and not crowd our all other facilities and make them into also places where there could be secondary infections that are taking place. And so therefore, that is one lesson that we need to do. If you're being taken care of at home, from home, you're going to a designated facility, and from a designated facility that has got enough capabilities to actually take you through to the advanced levels of support that you require during the course of your stay there. And that's something that we need to kind of be mindful of. I'm mindful that we are also running short on time on some of these sessions. And so therefore, just hold on for the panelists who were there from the previous panel. Unlike regular physical conferences where the chairs need to be moved and other people need to kind of come and sit on the advantages of a virtual conference like the one that ISW has today put together for the first time on coronavirus, people don't have to go out. In fact, Sujit has, Dipanjan has kind of stayed on right from the beginning. Dr. Sanjeev has stayed on from the beginning. And some of you, I'm welcoming you to kind of stay on, because we have a specific case, a session that we're going to look at where it may not be possible to, let's put it this way, put people into COVID-specific settings. These are a special case of people who are undergoing their cancer treatments. Oncologists, oncology-related treatments, are also at very high risk because of their immune status of contracting COVID-related infections. And so therefore, what do we do in that kind of a setting? And so therefore, we have with us, I can see Dr. Rawal from Rajiv Gandhi Institute already join us. I believe we have Dr. Gupta, Dr. Babu, and Dr. Warrior, and Dr. Ved all coming in. Are they already on? I'm not sure whether I can see the participant list right now. Yes, I think I can see the names already. Dr. Gupta is already here. I can see Dr. Rawal. Can I see Dr. Warrior? Is he here? And Dr. Ved, is he here? And Dr. Babu. We need the specificity of COVID hospitals, but we also recognize, let's put this way, special circumstances and oncology and cancer care becomes a special case within the overall response. And so therefore, let me turn to Professor Rawal. Where do you think, given the recommendations that are being talked about earlier on, that we need to avoid admixture, we need to avoid having COVID-related patients in our regular facilities, and we need to direct them to specific ones. How do you deal with it as a hospital, a tertiary care hospital for cancer? Dr. Rawal. And may I request the others to keep your mics on mute, and that's good hygiene for such virtual conferences till you're asked. Dr. Rawal? Can't see you. Sir, your mic is on mute. Sir, your mic is on mute. Professor Rawal, your mic is on mute. Now. Thank you so much. Professor Gupta, if you can keep your mic on mute, please.
Yeah, so yes, Dr. Bobby, we work in a pure cancer center, exclusive cancer center. We had a meeting as soon as this pandemic started. And we were going through the many guidelines from abroad also, and we have National Cancer Grid, guideline, which they had a meeting, all the cancer hospital, they had a meeting like this meeting. There was a Zoom meeting, and then they came up with many facts and suggestions for the cancer hospital who are dealing such patients. Because we have patients who are on chemotherapy, who have had bone marrow transplant, and who do require continuation of the treatment and the surgery. Surgery itself comes in a semi-emergency type. It's not that like a cold surgery. So I had talked with my friend in MD Anderson also, what are they doing? And that is what, this is how we are dealing right now, the situation in our hospital. We are having triage in front of emergency and in front of reception. Before any patient comes, he goes through that triage, and the history is taken about any contact, fever, sore throat, or anything. If it's suspicious, patient goes to the nearby hospital. Like we are in Rajiv Gandhi Cancer Hospital, so he goes to Ambedkar Hospital. And if the patient is cool, and other thing that we have followed is the follow-up patient, we are not taking them. We are telling them, you can talk to us on phone and they will connect to the concerned doctor. And we are telling them to delay their follow-up for 2-3 weeks since till this situation settles. And this is how our attendance of the OPD has come down to only 25% now. It used to be like 100%, then the attendance is only 25 patients. New patients we are taking only when they are, if they are domestic. They are national patient, we are taking. We are not taking international patient at all. We are sending them for quarantine or other hospital, like if they have any history of fever and all, then they, unless these patients are actually staying in Delhi for few months here, like Nepalese patient, they come here, they stay here for, they are there for a few months, then they are coming to us. Otherwise they are going for quarantine. As far as chemotherapy is concerned, the guidelines and which we are following is that if the patient is new and chemotherapy can be delayed, we ask him to wait for 2-3 weeks or maybe a month. Otherwise, he goes for chemotherapy. If the patient is old patient who is on chemotherapy, we are taking him. Now, bone marrow transplant, we are not doing transplant for thalassemia, but for if the AML like emergency situation is there, the patient will go for bone marrow transplant. And in the surgery also, if the surgery is cold surgery, if suppose there is a small kidney mass or there is a small tumor which can be postponed for 2-3 weeks, we will not take him. We'll ask them to come later on. But otherwise, we will operate them after taking all the precautions.
So what I'm hearing from you, Dr. Rawal, is this, that by and large, you're only restricting yourself to those that need to be done.
Yes.
Anything that can be pushed out, you're kind of...
Absolutely.
Delaying or kind of staggering it out. Professor Webb, let me kind of ask you this. Within this whole COVID scenario, I know that and operationally, I mean, the Rajiv Gandhi Institute has already kind of said how they're kind of triaging out or sequencing out. Where do you think we will be when we have all our facilities really running full, and we also have, and our cancer patients are not going away? They will need continuous care. How do we kind of make sure that we are protecting them? And postponing is one side of the story, but how do we actually institute protection measures within those facilities?
So the protection measures for these patients would be part of the general guidelines which are already available, that keeping the social distance and et cetera, use of the protective masks and all that. These are the general guidelines which are in place. So nothing new for as far as our patients are concerned. The same general guidelines would prevail for this group of patients as well.
Would you have guidance for the families of these patients also?
So what we are generally, sort of encouraging the families are that try and restrict the number of attendants who are coming to the hospital. So we know that our hospitals have one of the issues is the large number of attendants who come with the patients as the caregivers, but we are trying to encourage them to be with only one family member if preferable, because if it is an outpatient visit or a daycare visit, one does not need more than one family members. Even on the inpatient basis, the same instructions are being applied, and the families are being encouraged to be with the least number of family members, maintain the social distance, and report the symptoms, if at all, which are applicable to anyone in the society at the moment. And also, the practice the hand hygiene and et cetera. So the general guidelines are applicable to this group of patients as well.
So the general guidelines is what you are kind of really reinforcing all the time to everyone.
Absolutely.
Right. Before I come back to you, sir, let me ask Dr. Warrior. I mean, we've heard the general guidelines, the management of the number of people that are in contact with the patient. We're also looking at how the postponement of the elective procedures are also being put out. But by and large, if people are on a schedule, then they have to be on a schedule, right? And then that's where your entire therapeutic regimen actually hinges on. How do we ensure that when people are moving, what is it that you want people to be aware of when they're coming in from their homes and into their facilities, or when they are in the hospital and going into the procedures? What is it that you want to be particularly done now? You're on mute, sir. You're on mute. We can't hear you. No, not your earphone. It will be on your screen. On your screen, if you can change, please, on your phone, unmute yourself. Yes, we can hear you now.
Yeah, you can hear you. Okay, fine. So in case if one of the patients there's a chemotherapy or any other radiation scheduled, we are following again on guidelines like we have some of the international guidelines, and as well as our state has come out with excellent guidelines. In which what we practice again is when if the patient is having a curable malignancy and is scheduled for an adjuvant chemotherapy, then probably we will offer them without any interruption. But if it is a palliative care, or if it is if the patient is not for any the intent of treatment is not a curative one, and it's only a palliation, and if the patient has no symptoms at the moment after receiving some cycles of chemotherapy, definitely we will postpone such chemotherapy schedules. And the next one is about the radiation. So some of the radiations which have already started will be continued without any interruption. And the new patients who are waiting for radiation to be started, again, we will triage, like those who are having curable malignancy and schedule cannot be changed much, will be offered radiation. And if something like the prostate cancer and all, we can start a new adjuvant hormones, and then again one or two cycles more so that the radiation can be pushed away. For surgeries, some of the surgeries, early breast cancer, we may have to offer surgery. Such patients, we are offering them surgery, but if it is very early and we think that we can postpone surgery for another 2 weeks, we will definitely give dates later than 2 weeks. This is what we practice now.
Right. Dr. Gupta, I mean, given that you're both a center where people are coming in, but you also have an education component there. The things that have already been said by Dr. Rawal, Professor Ved, Dr. Varia, is there a guideline or a communication that is already out there for the oncology community on the lines that of the practice that are already there? Because you can't postpone some things in this space. Is there some guideline already out from the community side or the oncology associations?
So if I understand you correctly, your question is whether there is already formal guidance on what oncologists should do in the current scenario. And my answer to that is yes and no, because the situation is evolving so rapidly that everybody is finding it hard to catch their breath. But yes, there is some guidance. There is guidance from the American Society of Clinical Oncology. There is very nice guidance from the National Health Service in UK about what oncology centers and oncologists should should do with their patients. There is also guidance from the University of Washington at Seattle. There is guidance from China. But you know, in this sort of a situation, one cannot adhere to the old mantra of level one evidence and, you know, the highest standard of practice. We have to all improvise, and our patients fortunately are understanding that we have to improvise and we have to deliver care to the best of our ability. And I think everything that the other panelists have said was very valid and appropriate. At Tata Memorial Center, we are trying to screen patients to see that those with fever and other symptoms suggestive of COVID-19 infection do not mingle with the others. We are trying to reduce the crowd that usually collects in all our hospital OPDs. We are calling patients at different points of time. We are prescribing remotely. They just go to the pharmacy and they directly collect their medications. We are trying to convert some of the intravenous regimens to oral regimens to reduce the exposure of patients in the outpatient clinic to a large gathering. We are trying to carry on with those treatments where irreparable harm will come to the patient if the treatment was not carried out immediately or in the next few days. But we are prioritizing, and some of the other treatments are then getting somewhat postponed. We are running actually running a call center in Tata Memorial Center, both in ACTREC and in Tata Memorial Hospital, where we are providing telephonic consultations to patients. Our patients come from far and wide, from all over India, and that's a little bit of a challenge. And unfortunately, many patients were caught in transit, and we are trying to help them the best that we can. One situation that we are facing in Mumbai, and I think others may also be facing, is the relative shortage of blood and blood products, because even the donors are finding it hard to make their way to the hospital. We are trying to mobilize the community so that we have enough donation of both blood as well as blood products as and when they are required. So we are prioritizing. We are trying to reduce the crowd in our OPD. We are trying to deliver treatments that will result in as little time spent in the hospital. And if the visit can be postponed, then that's the best thing that we can do to our patients at the current time.
Thank you, sir. May I just quickly turn to Dr. Babu? I mean, because you have made an excellent point. And I want to, when I kind of come to summarizing it, you have made something that I think should be a public service message. And going back to our thing, but before that, let me just hear from Dr. Babu and then summarize what this group of eminent oncologists have spoken. Dr. Babu from Kidra Institute.
Yeah, Dr. Again, the thing is that I agree all the eminent speakers what they told. Similarly, in the same lines, what we are practicing. The question is, now because of the 21 days lockdown, the number of OPD patients or whatever patients we are seeing, it has reduced almost 90%. So we are seeing only about 10% of patients. What will happen if we open this lockdown and open the gates? For example, for a medical OPD in Kidwai, we will see around 500 cases a day with the 6 consultants sitting. Now, if you go on that, so even if you try to reduce by 50-60%, you and you'll be land up in saying around 300 patients. So how are we going to manage when all these things open up? So what we are doing is now currently we are seeing all the guidelines and trying to postpone it for 3 weeks. So now what we are going later on, that is the biggest question. So currently what we are following is the same thing what others do. Like we are doing triage initially, and we are, you know, running all chemotherapies, prioritizing the patients who are in curative intent to give them more treatment, palliative we are trying to postpone. So those things we are doing. But I don't know how we are going to handle when these things go. So that's the thing.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Babu. I mean, you raise another operational question. It's almost like we are pressure cooking our number of patients by holding them back. When we come into a point where people think that it's going to be safe to go out without having adequately informed people that the 21-day lockdown is not a cure, but is only buying time and getting us a little bit more of space and resources to do it, it is going to be very, very important to manage the flow of especially vulnerable
people to be turning up into healthcare settings where they may be at risk of contracting infections. And so that's one part of it. But I want to kind of, we've had five very eminent oncologists from different parts of the country come together. Dr. Gupta, you kind of said that we have guidelines from the American College, we have got the NHS, we have got others. I think it is about time. We don't need to wait for others, but at least a rough and ready operational kind of guidance to be given on certain aspects of our care for those that are with cancer-related interventions, that these are the do's and don'ts, and I'd rather that a group of you come together and put it out there, and we can kind of support you in getting that out, but not having that right now and saying that we have external clinical guidance alone is probably a wasted opportunity. And I want to kind of encourage you to consider together coming as different institutes and leaders of the field to be able to put together a guideline. That's one part. The second part is this, and this is something as a public service. Blood donors. Yesterday, there was somebody who needed blood in a particular institute in Delhi, and for 12 hours, they were asking for a blood donor, and nobody turned up. And the reason why people didn't turn up was they are not classified as essential workers. So in figuring out how a potential blood donor is also given a priority to move to a hospital is something that we need to probably pick up. And that's one thing, Dr. Gupta, that's one thing that I would very particularly take up as something that needs to be communicated to our decision makers and to our district level authorities, that if somebody is going to donate blood, if it's a designated blood donor, especially for oncology or other related emergency services, that they should be given a pass without fail. Dr. Gupta and Dr. Ven, to close this out.
I make a point here. The point regarding the guidelines being available from India, there is a document which is being prepared by the Indian Cooperative Network, and that is being put out. That's again based on the internationally available resources, because as Sudeep has said, that there is nothing which is written as a document, and we are learning every day. But there are some guidelines which have been put up by the Indian Cooperative Network. They are available in the public.
Right. Thank you, sir. Dr. Gupta, you wanted to close out on this one.
So actually, on the blood donation bit, I can just share what we have done. We have established a hotline with the Commissioner of Police of Navi Mumbai, and we already knew him earlier, so that helped. And anybody who wishes to donate, the request for donation is up on Twitter, on our website, on a special email, on WhatsApp groups. And we have a ready list of donors who are willing to donate to us, and we have the vehicles to pick them up, and the police will not stop them.
Thank you so much, sir. I mean, this brings us to kind of an end for this particular focus session on a particular cancer thing. Dr. Babu, you wanted to say something. I see your finger. Yes. Unmute yourself, Dr. Babu.
About the blood donors. I think all cities doesn't have so much facility. What we can do is we can ask the blood, banks to send a SMS to that person who is donor, so that he can show to the police and telling that I am going to donate the blood today, such times. Why don't you let me in and go out? They can do that.
Fair point. And operationalizing this is something that at IHW, the organizers of this virtual conference, will definitely write both to the Ministry of Health and to the various other responsible authorities to figure out a modality for streamlining this. Dr. Ved, the last word to you on this one.
So for the oncologists who are practicing in the hospitals, because there would be some cases who would come back to the hospital with fever and suspected symptoms, there is a learning which is coming from Italy. What they were doing was that in the ER, in the emergency rooms, they were taking up these patients as suspected cases, would send the sample for testing for COVID, and would be kept in the triage, would be kept in the emergency room till the report would not come, and treat them as on the merit of the infection or the suspected infection. These patients would never get mixed up with the general oncology patients. They would never move to the wards. They would never move to the general area before their report would come in. And that's a very valid point. I had actually logged in a little earlier, and what Harsh Mahajan said, that having these patients mix up in the hospitals, in a general hospital, would actually be a disaster. Imagine an oncology patient who's actually a febrile neutropenia, who comes into the emergency and also has a COVID or doesn't have a COVID. It's a complex problem. So the oncology patients have a severer infection, would be more complex, would be difficult to diagnose, and would pose a real challenge. So the ER has to be very, very robust in every hospital to identify these patients, do the testing, and then only move these patients into the facilities. Otherwise, it's going to be a disaster.
And absolutely, thank you so much. I mean, Dr. Rawal, Dr. Vaid, Dr. Warrior, Dr. Babu, Dr. Gupta. I mean, this is panel on oncology as a special case within a larger pandemic situation, and how we manage that has been an eye opener for me too, in terms of looking at the specific, sometimes the specific sticking points that actually make the difference between a good outcome and a complete kind of a waste of all the effort that has been put into getting somebody into that particular moment of well-being or in their journey towards well-being. Thank you so much for being there. Unlike real conferences where people kind of have to vacate their seats and then kind of make way for the next panel to come in, the advantage of a virtual one is that you can continue to stay on and be part of the conversation. And I'm very grateful that Dr. Deepanjan Roy and Dr. Sanjeev Kumar have stayed on from the first session. Dr. Mangal from the second session has kind of stayed on. If you wish to stay on, we'll be very, very privileged, because then we can kind of open up the question or somewhere you can kind of also intervene. But I want to introduce the new set of people that have come in for our last session this afternoon. We have Dr. Navakar, who is the director of AIIMS Raipur. We have Dr. Peter John Victor, from the director of CMC Velo. We have, who else do we have here? We have the director of AIIMS in Bhopal. So welcome. And who else do I have here right now? I think that's all the new people that we have got on board. We are hoping that we will have two more people join us. Professor Sarman Singh, Professor Saman Singh, you're already here. And Anil Dikros from Bombay to also join in, and Dr. Chabra from Vasant Kunj Spinal Injury Center. At this point in time, I want to kind of, before I get into the new folks that have joined us, I just want to kind of have a quick recap with both Dr. Sanjeev Kumar and Deepanjan. We started with the flattening of the curve, the preparedness for what is coming on, a special case in terms of oncology. And as we get, now we've got the senior institute directors also here. This is where the capacities are. What is it that we need to be preparing for is a question from a public health perspective. And then I'll kind of look at it from a very operational specific perspective to Deepanjan. First, Dr. Sanjeev Kumar.
You want us to repeat about flattening of the curve?
No. Just as broadly, a very quick, what is it, what is these gentlemen who have got large institutions under their helm, what is it that they need to be kind of now looking at?
Yeah, no, flattening of the curve means we need to reduce the number of cases. I gave an example, if one person infects four, in five rounds of transmission, you will have 65,000 cases. If you reduce it to one, you will only have 16 cases. This is what it means, so that you can mobilize resources, you can build up capacity, which is called surge capacity, and prepare the system briefly. I wanted to add two things from the previous panel. There, if you develop symptoms, don't have to rush from one hospital to the other. In every state, the advisory we issued from Indian Public Health Association, every state has given out a number. All that number, they will advise you if you need to go. They will talk to you about your symptoms and then tell you where to go. Or in some of the cases, they may also be able to send somebody home to pick you up. So for example, in Delhi, the number is 011-2230-715. For every state has given out that number. Until we were getting the print newspaper, there was one full page advertisement which was giving this number and do's and don'ts. So that information was not given in the second panel. I want to add that. Third point I want to add is there are 11 countries in the lockdown, not just India. One third of the world's population is in lockdown, including developed countries. France and Italy, for example, including the developing countries, Jordan, South Africa, for example, there are 15 countries in partial lockdown. At least right. There may be more. US and Philippines are there. And there are closed border in another 14 countries, including Canada and Australia. Third point I want to emphasize, we are contributing to stigma if we are scaring people. And that stigma is affecting healthcare providers as well, not just the patient. That is the third point from public health point of view we need to be taking care of. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you. Dr. Mangal, you were saying, Dean IIHMR from Jaipur, you were saying something.
I was listening to this conversation of the prior group very carefully, and it was very, very informative that in specific situations, like patients suffering from cancer and those who are on immunosuppressive therapies, how to continue to provide them services and how to protect them from catching infectious diseases like COVID. Now, in a specific situation of pandemic like this, you know, surge capacities can be created because the Epidemic Act is in place. Now, I think this is a case, very classic case, where we need to look at the basic healthcare delivery structures and processes. An ideal situation would be where the care for critically ill people from other diseases continues to be there, and the system is able to take care of new challenges, whether it is COVID or any other illness or communicable diseases in future. And from that perspective, I think this is an opportunity to look at the way the public health competencies and capacities are created and utilized in our country. Now, I'm really concerned about the fact that, and I'm also appreciating that all of us are coming together in this very specific situation, and everybody is contributing their bit. But by design, what is the plan, or what should be the plan in future, that we do have epidemiologists, we do have public health people, and we do have a plan in place to enhance the public health competencies of large number of paramedics to deal with
absolutely
enormous amount of number of cases that we need to, we may have to deal. If, and hopefully we will be successful in this phase of lockdown to curtail and cut down the surge, and we will flatten the curve. But otherwise, what is our thought for future to prepare ourselves? I would like to add very quickly that, you know, the public health and epidemiology enables us to deal with new diseases, even if we do not have any clue of what causes them or any clue of what is the diagnosis. That has been
right, sir.
This focuses our attention.
May I request that because Dipanjan, I mean, if you very quickly kind of one point very quick before, because we are very, very busy heads of institutions here, if you can very quickly summarize and then I get to the directors here.
Thank you, Bobby. My quick context and summarization, and also we have esteemed directors. See, as we progress in the epidemic, we are going to have more number of cases. It's the larger institutions which will take care of the serious cases. It's the proportion of the cases which is going to get serious, you know, maybe 10 to 15%, and you will require. So, you know, that's the next phase of epidemic plan. When you do a phasing, you have the phase one, phase two. We're still, as such, as of now, not gone into the phase three, as per the recent reports of ICMR. But phase three would happen, you know, in a large country like us. Whatever safety net you put in, it is bound to have some amount of seepage, some amount of problems. So, obviously, the number of cases are going to go up maybe 2 weeks down the line or maybe a week down the line. So, the panel, which is esteemed panel, which is here, what are the kind of preparatory activities is being planned out there? What are the kind of isolations? What are the kind of other things? And that would probably take us through in reducing the number of deaths in this case. That's the epidemic control. You know, that's one of the major things. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, thanks, Dipanjan. I mean, we have two AIIMS directors. We have the CMC Velo director. We have Dr. Chhabra from ISIC Delhi.
one of the things that we saw in the last couple of days was the in New York, they were basically saying medical graduates could graduate 3 months earlier, provided they were coming into service for the COVID response, right? And so there are countries that are beginning to look innovatively at where their surge capacity might come through. Each of you gentlemen are helming institutes of national importance, and you have training capacities. You also have got service delivery capacities. What is it that you are seeing right now from your respective positions as to what needs to be done? And may I start with Professor Sarman Singh from AIIMS Bhopal. So you're on mute. Set up mute pair.
Okay. Gee. Am I okay now? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So thank you and good afternoon. And sharing this, and I was just listening to the previous panel also, and very rightly somebody said that, you know, ICE is a, you know, one important aspect, but, you know, you started your introduction with the, you know, training part. So I would also start from the training part, because, you know, there was a, in last 2 weeks back, you know, last fortnight, there was a hue and cry in parents of, and they said that, you know, what you are looking for when you are going to close the medical college. And obviously, we waited for about few days, and then ultimately we realized that, you know, on the lines of AIIMS Delhi, we also thought that, you know, why not let them go? Because even if we keep them, even though we thought that, you know, at that time, of course, now we have two cases of corona in Bhopal, but at that time we were not having any single case of COVID. But the anxiety of the parents, obviously one can understand. So we decided that even though they were safest in Bhopal, but we allowed them to go and to back at the hostel. You very rightly said that some of the countries, they have also asked for final year students. We also asked to volunteer, that we didn't do something like that, you know, they can graduate earlier, but definitely we thought that we might give some, you know, certificate or something like appreciation. So that is there, definitely, but our interns, our junior residents, senior residents, all are working, and we have been, you know, successful in, you know, motivating them with various means, and they are with us. But as we discussed, the previous, you know, panelists also, and we all know that the number of cases is going to increase by, you know, in all boundaries. Now, then question comes that our resident, including even though they have become doctors, they know the all the things, nurses and doctors, even though they are meant for, but the COVID-19 has made such a dent in the understanding and psyche of the even the healthcare workers, that they are really scared. They are really scared, and the number one, because the COVID is such a highly infectious, you know, virus. Number two, we don't have, you know, PPEs. The supplies is making huge impact on the, you know, consideration and the, you know, hesitation of the healthcare workers to extend their services. And even if these are available, they are of, you know, very, you know, substandard quality. And even though the national government is also helpless, we have not been too able to. Nevertheless, we at AIIMS Bhopal, considering that obviously the pandemic touched Madhya Pradesh quite late, and so was, you know, Chhattisgarh also, so this central India, but we know that, you know, cases are going to come definitely. So now what we have done, that, you know, we have identified one 2-floor building, which is usually, this was earlier, this was used for, you know, IUs. But now we have dedicated, so this can hold the all patients and screen, also testing and sampling, everything can be done. And then if the samples are on positive, then obviously they can shift to the medical ward. So, and then medical ward also, then we have, you know, with symptoms and without symptoms. So means corona positive, right, asymptomatic, and then symptomatic also. Sure. So symptomatic obviously will go to third stage. Yeah.
Gee. Yeah, so I'm just going to restrict myself to the training part of it. So, Dr. Victor, I mean, CMC Velo, again, a premier training center, also some a place where people turn up for their treatments, things like that. How are you considering the training requirements or putting in more people out there at an earlier stage of their training into the actual case management scenarios?
Thank you. I just want to give a very brief background because I think I will be able to, yes, to answer your question. Can you hear me? So we are normally running a 3,000 bedded facility with patients that come from all over the country and overseas. So we have good capacity. After the announcement of the lockdown by our Honorable Prime Minister, we have started looking at it in a slightly different perspective as to how we can create sufficient capacity to deal with all the patients from within the district. Ultimately, because of the lockdown, we feel that we need to provide enough capacity for all patients who might come and to strategize and stratify patients about how many isolation beds we need and how many critical care beds we need and how we staff them. In terms of stratification, we know that moderately ill patients would need hospitalization. At CMC, we have already created 150 beds for moderate illness by reducing our elective surgeries and by reducing our outpatient and inpatient services. By next week, we will be able to double the capacity to 300 beds for potential patients. And we're working with the government. They want us to have 500 beds. And we're working towards that. We have a potential advantage here because we were already converting a student nurse's hostel into an orthopedic block, which is due to be ready next month. That will give us 150 additional beds, including beds. We are also in the process of constructing a state-of-the-art trauma facility, which is 3 months from completion. And if it comes to that state, we will request permission from the government to expedite that process. That we can have another 1,500 bedded hospital ready in 3 months' time. And that has 215 beds. So in terms of intensive care, we currently have all intensive cares put together about 130 beds, of which only 24 have been designated for SARI patients. And we will be able to add another 12 by next week and a further 12 in the following week. We feel that we can stretch intensive care capacity to about 50. We have currently 1,600 doctors, half of whom are permanent faculty, and another half are postgraduates and higher specialty trainees, and 3,000 nurses.
Sorry, I was on mute. Thank you, Dr. Victor. I mean, every one of those numbers is so impressive when it's standing alone. I mean, a new facility of 1,500 beds coming in 3 months' time, or 150 intensive care beds, or 3,000 nurses that are there full-time. On their own, they are extremely impressive. But what scares me is the denominator that you put in very early on, which is that your estimation is that you might be overwhelmed by 21,000 people, right? And so that kind of gives us a scale that no matter how much we have, it still is going to be something that we're going to be stretched against. And so that's where we need a lot more of both planning and also devolution of some of the capabilities that we have to somebody else. Institutions like the AIIMS and CMCs will have to provide the leadership and the models. How we kind of then get replicated down is going to be the challenge and how we kind of do that. And so therefore, Dr. Nagarkar, I mean, from AIIMS Raipur, I mean, again, like Dr. Saman Singh said, from Bhopal, Chhattisgarh seem to be, let's put it this way, not yet in the reckoning, so to say, the leaderboard of numbers. But already, what is your planning there? If you may go ahead, please.
Thank you so much, Dr. John, and the entire team of elite panelists. Yes, I think this preparedness, which has been the key word, social distancing, another key word that we've been hearing and we've been actually implementing for the last few weeks. We at AIIMS Raipur have received the directives from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, and accordingly even from the state government, that ours should be the nodal center for any cases that could be coming up in the state of Chhattisgarh. Our lab, which is the state VIDL lab, was the reference lab, and they have screened more than 300 samples as of now. Patients come daily for a separate dedicated center which is for COVID-19. 6 patients are positive, of which 4 are already admitted in our hospital and are getting care from our expert doctors, nursing staff, and all the rest of the support staff. So although it is with a trickle, but it has started. And that's where actually the key word of preparedness, you know, comes in. We had kept our facilities ready.
We multiply that yours by say 100 times. Can we look at your people becoming, let's put it this way, telemedicine or a distance training? Can we talk to Zoom and say, how does one facility, one senior registrar from your hospital or from Raipur or from Bhopal now provide supervisory support for somebody who's at the sub-district level? We may need to do that. The physical infrastructure may be the least of our problems. Our problem might be the actual brains or the capacity, the clinical oversight for something that a frontline ASHA worker may be pressed into doing. And that's where I'm leaving the challenge back with each of you as directors of teaching institutions. Can you put together very quickly a set of rough and ready guidelines that says, this is what needs to be done, and this is what can be pulled down, so that in the next 20 days that's left behind, we have some kinds of manuals. I know that mission hospitals or smaller hospitals down the line are all asking for what can we do. People are willing, but they need the guidelines, and it needs to come from institutes like you. And so therefore, one of the things that at IHW in putting this virtual conference together was also to see how this can be resulting in a few rough and ready guidelines. We've already asked the oncologists, we've asked the public health people, the testing people, and then there are other people right now. We've got Dr. Mangal here from IHMR, we've got Dipanjan here from PwC, we've got others who can kind of put together whatever you're throwing into something that's coherent, so that it can be made available both for the Ministry of Health and also for the larger community. We are at 5:16. We started at 3 o'clock. Some of you have stayed here right from the beginning till this moment. For many of you who have joined us on the YouTube channel, this is a unique experience for us. Earlier, we used to run conferences inside rooms that had only 200 people or 300 people, and they used to be closed door. This conversation for us has been the first time it's gone out. We don't know how many people have watched this. But I hope that whatever you've heard does not merely kind of, does not cause you alarm, but all encourages you to think creatively, that there are solutions possible. And freedom. I mean, you have the YouTube channel where you're kind of responding back to us, or you can write to us at the IHW Council website, or to each of the people that you have kind of seen on the screen through the last 2.5 hours or so. Let the conversation go. This is a moment for us to mobilize and bring our best ideas together. Last thing, let's have social solidarity. We cannot have social distancing. We have to have social solidarity. We have to have physical distancing, whether it's at the cancer hospital, whether it is at our mediated through our telehealth facilities or the calling and triage facilities, whichever way it is, let's prevent ourselves from being at a position of risk and putting somebody else at risk. Wash hands properly. Make sure that if you're coughing, you're wearing a mask. The rest of you don't need to make a mask. In fact, I mean, I hope all of you that you're watching this on the YouTube, you would have realized that none of the people who have come here are wearing masks. None of them are actually out there coughing out. But those that are, you need to put a mask on, and you need to be making sure that you are also quarantining yourself, keeping yourself away from infecting somebody else. If you have a fever and if you have a chest tightening, please make that phone call number. I think Dr. Sanjeev Kumar gave us the Delhi numbers. I think there are numbers for every single state, and there are toll-free numbers. Please make those calls that you can get the appropriate guidance. Tests should not be limited. I know that we have talked about testing earlier on. I know that there is a thought that we should not be indiscriminately using tests, but as clinicians, as public health people, we know that what you don't know does not point you to where you need to go to. What you know is what helps you refine your approaches. And so therefore, figuring out, again, a national effort to get rough and ready testing or complementary science that allow us to triage people in is important. And let's stand behind our medical care workers. It is very easy. Today, everybody is talking about them as demigods. Tomorrow, when things start going bad, and for many, many people, it will go bad. In the same breath, let's continue to support them. Let's not turn against them and say they did a bad job. Because face it, there will be bad outcomes. Not everybody is going to have a good outcome. And the very busy, very tired, very stretched medical care worker is going to be somebody who has done his or her best. They should not be stigmatized. They should not be pointed at. They should not be ostracized. They should not be acted in violence against. They need your highest care and support. And I hope that this message does go out when things get bad. Right now, everybody's looking at us with hopeful eyes. We will do our best, and we have the best brains, best intentions in place. Despite that, the burden may overwhelm us. Stand with us is all we would say. On behalf of the IHW Council, thank you so much for each one of you for having taken the time to come here. You may not have seen the people that have seen what you have said, but I believe the virtual world has the ability to kind of propagate your messages far beyond what we imagine. And so therefore, thank you for devoting your time, for making available whatever information that you have put together. Some of the things that we need to work together, we will be following up with you. But for everybody, thank you from the ISW Council for having been with us for the last two and a half hours. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bobby.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We are facing a grave crisis and we need to augment our human resource, infrastructure and equipment and be very innovative in order to meet this big challenge which faces us all. When it comes to human resource, the government can consider various measures to augment the human resource. Like there are a lot of people waiting for their examinations for their graduation, and there are precedences from UK where the General Medical Council of UK skipped the final examination and gave them a degree based on their past performances. Similarly in Italy, they cut short the duration of the graduation by as long as 10 months and gave them graduation without examinations. Similarly, there are a large number of people who have come and trained from China and Russia, and we can have them given a degree provisionally so that they can contribute to the human resource requirements of the country. When it comes to specialists, we have around 50,000 specialists waiting for an examination, and like the American model where they are either board eligible and then after the examination become board certified, we can give them the rights to practice right now and they can become board certified subsequently after the examinations are done. So similarly, we have a large number of specialists who are deregistered because their societies from which they registered are no longer certified by the Medical Council of India. But in this hour of crisis, the government may consider letting them practice so that they can contribute to the human resource requirements of the country. Similarly, we need to gear up for the infrastructure. We need to have a large number of beds ready, whether that is in the government hospitals or in the private hospitals, or whether we have the stadia, the hotels, the railway coaches being geared up to provide medical facilities and hotels for quarantine facilities. There are a lot of things which can be considered. Also very important is to gear up the intensive care beds, as was clearly seen from the example of Germany and Italy, where the number of increased intensive care beds in Germany led to a substantial reduction in the mortality in this country as opposed to Italy, where the number of beds were low. In India, the number of beds are still lower and we need to gear up so that we can have an adequate intensive care beds and we can have adequate ventilators. We need to be innovative and think how we can have the local manufacturers come up with ways and means so that we can meet the needs of the country. Another requirement would be from the PPEs, personal protection equipment, which are needed in large number, the oxygen, the suction, and various measures like telemedicine, which the government has cleared now with fresh guidelines. This would play a big role if we were to meet the big challenge. So in a nutshell, in this hour of crisis, we need to pool resources, we need to gel like a team, we need to side with the government, and together we should be able to meet this big challenge and come out successfully. Thank you.